Hello, my delicious co-creators. Lilou here. I'm in beautiful Paris in front of Jardin du Luxembourg and the Sénat that we have right behind us. And this is a special interview because I have Kenny that is a Maasai. Tell us your full name, Kenny.
My name is Kenny Matampash.
It's an honor to have you here. You know that?
It's my pleasure. And I really feel honored that I can have an interview with you. To share what I think is important for the world today to listen.
Yes. Speak about the spirituality of the Maasai and your message and why you're here right now. There's Xavier that is next to you. That's kind of like your white brother.
I'm happy to be with my friend Xavier Perron, who have been a friend for a long time, almost 30 years now. We've been together, and we're working together to dig deeper into the Maasai cultural values that are really based on spirituality. And as co-creators, I think we have a responsibility to make this planet a better place for all to live in harmony with nature. Because for the Maasai, the spirituality of the Maasai comes from nature itself, the cosmos, that we are part and parcel of that cosmos, and we are responsible to make sure that this planet is safe for us to live in harmony with nature itself. And these are some of the values that I would like the world to listen and to know.
Yeah. Sometimes it doesn't feel safe. We'll go back to that, because we have this feeling, we have all these fears, and we're run by fears on a day-to-day basis. And there's reasons why you're here now, you know, and you spend more time now. Xavier, what does this mean to you? I mean, you are this anthropologue. I mean, you did a PhD on this. You spend your whole life, you know, traveling back and forth. This means a lot for you to share this information right now.
Yes, but I want to leave facts, to go deeper. You know, I've gone through my own initiation being in the West after having lived in Maasai land for several years. My real initiation was here, and in fact, I put into practice what I learned in Maasai land, which is not easy. But that's what I want to say to the people, that they can manage. Because it's very practical thing, keys, very practical.
And we'll talk more with Kenny about this, but why is it difficult for us to put this into practice?
Because of the mental, you know, we live in separation between the body and the spirit. And although for the Maasai, all is connected, all is together. Yeah. And the Maasai comes from Ilmao, which means twins. Which means it reflects the spirituality of the pair. Yeah. That all is functioning with pairs, with two elements.
Yeah, because we know in other cultures, like it's the yin and the yang, and so the is inside, outside. So there's this paradox, yet we have to accept both, I guess, right? We can't reject one. We can't go either for the inside or for the outside.
Of course, you cannot reject. Both are there to complement each other, to have the balance, to have the equilibrium. Mm. Of course, there's left and right, there's black and white, there's a woman and a man. Those two are important for the balancing. Mm. And I think the nature itself is balanced. Mm. It's only the human person or beings that are putting the world to become in balance in doing so many things, that nature is not comfortable in it. And that is a contradiction.
Yeah. So there is a path. There is an initiation. So there is some rituals or practices to little by little incorporate this inside. I mean, to reconnect with inside of us, to reconnect with the outside nature and the cosmos. What is this path?
For us, it is not that we are looking for spirituality. We are not looking for. It is there already. Mm. We got it from the day we were born. Mm. And we go through several stages of initiation to grow how to become and how to be. Mm. To be shown ways where you can nurture and nourish this planet. So for the Maasai, it is not something that you look from the books or from somewhere, because it's there. It is inside us. Mm. So it's not something that we are looking.
Yeah.
No.
But is it by contemplating? Is that by observing? Is that by meditating? Or just sitting there and looking at the beauty outside? Or how do you phrase it?
Through the day-to-day practical doing it, you appreciate the nature because it's the mother of us all. Yeah. So it is not something that you learn. It is inborn. It's in you. Because as I said, nature is everywhere. I mean, the spirit is everywhere. The spirit is in nature. The spirit is in plants, in water, in the soil. It is there. You are not looking for it. For us, it's practice those values that make the world a better place to live.
Mm. Xavier?
I would just add something. It's just learned also through rituals. No, they are taught how to give without fear. And to receive by saying thank you to Enkai or to the others. You know, it's the equilibrium. They are taught how to give and how to receive because of polarity of the world. Huh? Yeah. They know that. They know that it's very simple, basic laws, cosmic laws. Huh?
Exactly.
Cosmic laws that they learn through rituals.
Yeah. Through the gratitude and through giving as much thanks as what you're receiving, basically.
Yes, exactly.
It's very true because, as I said, within the Maasai society or community, you are never alone. You can never walk alone. You cannot stay alone. You are never lonely. Our riches are the values that we have. Mm. It's not the external riches.
Yeah.
It's the internal riches.
Yeah.
And that is what makes us strong and that makes us rooted.
Yeah.
As opposed to the consumer society, which is out for production and consumption.
Mm.
And that builds the ego that you want to protect. You say, me.
Mm.
We say, we. Mm. We are together.
Mm.
We do it together. It's not me.
Mm.
And then that's why people don't care about the environment, about what happens, because they are so egocentric in their minds and in their brains, mm. because they are brought up in a certain form of education in a box. They want to make the world a standardized world. You cannot. There's nothing like a global village. That's, for me, it doesn't happen. It's not there.
Huh? And yet we're interconnected. So we are one. A lot of people have this conversation about being one. And yet we have something unique to value as well.
Exactly.
Like the Maasai are different than
exactly.
Parisians.
Exactly. Yes, indeed, what I do not believe is the manipulation of others by others.
Mm.
People must have their own space, their own freedom to practice, to do what they feel is better for themselves and for the world.
Mm.
But the objective is to make this planet a better place for us all. Because we have only one planet, this one only. And if we are not careful about it, we may not be what we are at the moment. And I think time is coming for the world to start thinking, what is our direction? How can we make it better?
Yeah. This can't happen through war. I mean, a lot of people protest, you know, like here in Paris, against something. But the more we protest against war, then the more war we have, right?
I mean, this is the reaction of the Mother Earth. Indeed, all over the world today, there is discomfort. People are not happy. People are looking for answers. There is something missing. There is a dislink. Where is that dislink? What is making it? Is it economics? Is it the social order? Is it the political order? Those are the hard questions. And you have to be very bold enough to stand up and say, this is the way things are happening, that we are no longer behaving as human beings. We are behaving as individuals, and we are treating others as objects. And this is what the big questions people are asking. The youth all over the world are dissatisfied. For what? What is the problem? The establishment, the political class should start questioning. There is a problem. Is it based on values? Is it based on consumption? Is it based on economics? What is it all about? But for me, I think it is the loss of the basic human values of respect, of sharing, of caring, of being concerned, of being in harmony with other people. That is lacking, and that's why there's a gap.
Yeah. Non-duality, yeah?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to add, Xavier?
Exactly. I just want to add something. When I arrived first time in Masailand, I was given a ritual which makes me understand very deeply the sense of humanity. I was given two pairs of meat, two pairs of with two pieces on, two pairs of pieces of meat. Okay, the first pair was meat, mean meat, mean meat, which was for which means rarity, scarce. When something is scarce, it's rare. And after, I was given fat, which is abundance. Okay, another pair was the right part of the heart, which was, in fact, for the Maasai, the rationality, the analytic brain. And the other one, it was part of lungs, the lung, okay, which means compassion. So it means that you need to have both to integrate, both, both elements, to make to remain in unity. We are suffering when we don't accept the other element. Okay.
Can you say it in other words, Kenny? Why is such a ritual? Is that something that Maasai do?
As I said, we do have 9 stages of initiation, and each stage are big ceremonies of celebrations. Yeah. And in these celebrations, there are also rituals that are performed by senior elders who have gone undergone through the 9 stages themselves. And through these ceremonies, the rituals that are being performed are basically connected with nature, mm-hmm. and the cosmos itself. Mm. It is to strengthen you to be able to be strong enough to face the realities of the world today and even before. So we see, if for us, if you haven't gone through the initiation, there's something lacking. I can compare this with my children who have gone through this initiation, and those of the same age who haven't gone. You can straight away say, this guy misses a certain stage of initiation.
So it's like this deep connection, this deep force that comes from reconnected to the goddess, to Mother Earth, but also the cosmos, right? This is the real, because we have grown up protecting ourselves, but this is not the force. This is not...
No, it is not the force. It is a connection with the cosmos itself, the nature. It is the real marrow of humanity, that connection with the cosmos, the nature itself.
More than faith.
More than faith. That is the point. More than faith.
There's nothing that can disturb that.
Not at all. Wow. Not at all.
That's powerful. That's powerful because we're constantly, I think, in our society, thinking, I need proof that this exists. I need proof that the invisible exists, that the universe is here.
You see, when they start asking those questions, I mean, they don't make sense. In fact, in a way, they are trying to play a game of manipulation. It's kind of a dogma that people should learn through that particular dogma. We don't have dogma in Maasai spirituality or cultural values. We don't manipulate. Mm. We do reality. We do the actual. Mm. So for me, I think all these other people who try to find ways and means of making people believe that there is a certain faith, to me, it is not true.
Yeah, in fact, Maasai never speak about spirituality. They just live it. They just live it, practice it. But they don't want to speak about it. So usually academic people, they don't see even that Maasai have spirituality. They're not interested in it anyway.
So it's a way of life, because we use spirituality here as a label. It separates one more time. But as a human being, we are this drop of God. Can we say we're this drop of the universe?
Indeed, we are, because we are made from the matter itself. And this matter is made from the universe. I mean, the cosmos itself. So we are just that little bit.
Like a piece of a star?
Like a piece of star. Yeah. Yes.
Yes, and when it rains, yeah. Enkai sends to the ground, the fluid, amniotic liquid, you know,
exactly.
The amniotic liquid in which life is growing.
Exactly.
In which it's very rare. It's the only people that.
So you're not. So when the earth brings the water, the rain, for you, it's. Do you see that as, or when it's not raining, how do you feel when there's no rain? You just know that there's perfection at all times. I mean. You know how when it rains, it's like this blessing, it's like this miracle, I guess, in Kenya.
When there are these big stresses like droughts and these guys are calling climate change, which of course it is a human phenomena, of course. When it rains, when there are stresses and all, for us, it's not a big worry. You have to go through in life, you have to go through the hardship, the challenges that strengthen you, you know?
Yeah.
So it's not only the best that makes you. In fact, you must have challenges to make you even stronger, to be able to resist, to be resilient, to even harder shocks. I mean, that is the situation. So when it rains, it's a big blessing. It's life. When there's drought, it's another stage of strengthening. It's part of that life for you even to be stronger.
The Maasai call it Osina Kishon, which means suffering is good for you. It's good. It's a blessing also. It's funny because it's not to be in earth to suffer, but it's to suffer not to suffer.
Exactly.
It's to be able to suffer to go step for another step.
It's the experience we need to grow to have. Do we speak about a soul in with the Maasai? Do they speak about the soul? Because our soul evolved through those difficulties.
We really do not have a word to say the soul. I think it is the empirical cord, the uterus itself.
Yes. That's interesting.
Which is actually the beginning of life.
Yeah.
That's where we feel the power is.
Very true.
That's where we feel the vibration come from.
But the uterus, tell us more about the uterus, because we know the female uterus.
Of course.
The uterus of Mother Earth?
There is uterus of Mother Earth. I mean, we are all of us in the uterus of Mother Earth.
Mm.
Eh? And the cosmos and the nature actually nourishes us and nurture us to grow to a realization that we are part of that maker.
Mm.
And we are part of that human peace that is given responsibility as co-creator to make it even better for generation and generation to come, but not to destroy it as it's happening now.
Yeah. So we're kind of in her womb right now.
Exactly.
In the womb of the universe. You know, I did this Watsu thing in the water. I felt like I was in the universe. It's kind of like that. Like this experience is actually where we're in this phase of being transformed, kind
it's
of.
Like when you're walking, as you're walking now, you're actually being carried in the mother's womb. I mean, you are being carried as you're walking. It's not that it's the earth you are just walking. Actually, you're within the hands and the womb of the mother earth.
Usually we don't see it like that. We see it quite threatening. We think that this universe is threatening.
Not at all. I mean, not at all. For us, we don't see it that way.
Yeah.
We start seeing it threatening when human beings themselves start actually disturbing the order of the planet itself by what we are doing now with the environment, with all this pollution and all this, you know, you can imagine what's happening.
Even that has its role, I guess. Even that is perfect. Even that is the suffering we need to grow as a humanity and species.
But
the bad things that are happening.
Exactly.
Right now.
The bad things that are happening to us are part and parcel of that life itself. You should never worry about this. You should never be saying, oh my God, I'm finished. You're not finished. Eh? It has to be there.
Yes.
To balance the equilibrium, to be able for you to withstand the nature itself.
Yes.
Yeah.
Just wanted to add something which is very interesting about Enkai. We, in fact, sky and earth are separated, but for the Maasai, it's not separated because Enkai is connected to us through the umbilical cord from the uterus, the holy uterus, the sky. We are nourished by that umbilical cord called osotwa. So the Enkai is nourishing us always, always. We don't have to worry. She knows exactly why we are here on Earth. What is our mission? We just have to let her indicate us the way.
I guess there's some form of prayers too, or rituals to thank this goddess, to thank Enkai.
Enkai. Of course, we do have prayers and blessings and ceremonies and rituals.
And dances.
And dances and celebrations. And they're all geared towards the praise of Enkai, yeah. The god. Even, for example, the women, when they go to milk animals, because we don't use machine, we do it practically, and normally done by women. The first milk the woman gets from the cow, the calabash, before he continues doing it, she has to thank Enkai for giving us the abundance of milk and cows and the nature, by showing by the signs of the cross, of the compass, the south, the north, the east. And they say, those in the east, those in the west, those in the south, those in the north, we are together, we are all sharing. And when person is dead, we don't believe in death, people don't die, we say people went to sleep. And when you are taking food, or say a wine, elders are taking wine, the first sip before you start drinking, the first sip, even milk, the first sip, you spit it in the ground, or you put it like that, and you say, for our ancestors, we are together. We are here with you. And at times when I look at the, because I remember one white person asked me, a Western person asked me, why do the Maasai pour milk on the ground and for their ancestors? Do you think they are there, they are receiving it? And then I say, of course, we know they are there, they are with us. And then I ask him, why do you take to flowers to the coffins or to the cemeteries, to the graves of dead people? Do you think that person is there to see the flowers? And then he laughed. And I said the same thing. We believe that people don't die. They actually just live. And they're always there with us.
It's beautiful.
Today we say the God of our ancestors, God of our fathers, we are here. Come nearer to us. And then we say, Enkai Osotwa, the God of the umbilical cord, feed us. Give us the power. So for us, it is practically done. And all ceremonies have prayers to praise and to thank the Creator.
It's beautiful. I can feel the power, the energy, this magic, even to bring all ancestors, all lives, all directions, all that in the present moment, and reuniting it all to live that one moment. How powerful if we would live every single second of our life like that.
And even during dancing, when you have got our dancing, because you don't have instrument, Maasai do not, they have only have a horn probably, and you see them jumping, the Maasai, they go up. It's the connection. You are the vibration of the earth up in the universe, up. We are communicating. Boop, 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 boop. And even
the heartbeat of the universe.
And the heartbeat of the universe. Yeah. And even the sound when they are really having big ceremonies like a Unoto and Kepata, and they say, woo, woo, woo. The sound. Woo, woo, woo. It is the communication. The sound. But when you are completely not connected, your face tells it all.
Yeah.
Your eyes tells it all.
There's no more light.
There's no more light in you. And that's why in my society, in my community, people are always happy. Yeah. They smile at you. They look at you. And they, you know, like, even if they don't know you, they smile at you. I have an experience when I went to a metro, a tube in London at one time. And I entered at 4 o'clock tube. It was full, and people are really, really rushing. And when I entered in and I looked at everybody, everybody is quiet. And I thought at that moment, am I in a wrong train? Is this train going to a funeral? why people are not talking? And at one point, I smiled at somebody in front of me. I thought it was a lady or a man, and I tried to smile, and the guy just turned that way. And I thought, what's wrong? And I thought I had something on my face. And I try again to smile, and then, why is the opposite from my community? Because when you go, even if you don't know somebody, you show the love. You know, you get into a bus in the community village, and you get in and say hello to everybody. And you sit next to a person, you know the person, you start talking. Where are you from? Where are you going? How are things? How are your cows? How are your animals?
But we're busy.
Here people say, what? You are busy of what? Time is there. There is never no time.
Yes.
There's no never no time. For us, time is not...
not real.
It's not real.
Yeah.
It's just a manipulation of sort.
Yeah, yeah.
Just to close yourself up.
Yeah. It's another excuse.
It's another excuse. There are many excuses.
Yeah.
That's one of them.
Yes.
How about for regarding the connection to when a person is sick? Do you have like shamans or is there healers? Who heals in the Maasai? I mean, how do you heal yourself when there is something going on?
There are many, like at the moment now, apart from meeting my friend Xavier Perron, I am working with a lady, Lucy Halbert, trying to identify Maasai plants, because Maasai use plants in different ways, because plants have different properties and values. Mm-hmm. We have got sacred plants that are used for ceremonies and rituals.
Such as
Oreteti, such as Oseki, such as Olorien. These are Maasai names, okay?
So that's like psychedelics type of, it's like ayahuasca or no?
Ayahuasca, what do you mean? Ayahuasca.
There's these plants that make you hallucinate a little bit and connect to the spirit. That's not what we're talking about.
No. But what I'm saying that Maasai plants have different purposes, and they are daily used. There are medicinal plants. There are plants that are used for ceremonies, for rituals. There are plants that are edible for food during hard times. There are plants that are used for craft. So what I'm doing now, but this knowledge has never been documented or written. It's oral language, oral transmission. I want to put this in recording and documenting so that we share this rich knowledge to the youth, the Maasai youth first, and to the world.
Yeah.
And I want the primary people today to start talking their own stories. We want to tell our own stories. Because, for example, the Maasai stories have been told, have been distorted by anthropologists, botanists, historians.
Not by me.
Well, many of them, some of them. It's good, but they are not properly placed.
Yeah.
We want to tell our own stories. And that's why I am interested in trying to put these things into perspective so that people really understand.
How many Maasai are around the world?
The world, of course. In East Africa, we have Maasai in Tanzania and Maasai in Kenya. They're almost 2 million now, because the Maasai in Tanzania, in the northern part of Tanzania, and the Maasai in Kenya, southern part of Tanzania. And with the borderline, which is imaginary to us, we cross as we want, because those are our cousins, uncles, and brothers. We don't have immigration laws and customs. We just cross it. So
That's refreshing.
Of course, it is really refreshing because we share the same custom, we share everything, even though we are from different governments and states.
Yeah.
Okay?
But I guess some Maasai, like you, you know, go out and try to share this or...
To share what?
To share this message. Or were you selected or did you select yourself? I mean, how did... Maasai also travel?
Nobody have selected me to do what I'm doing. I think it's a call.
Yeah.
As I said... I went through the Western education up to the university level. I've traveled to the United States, Washington, D.C. I studied in Washington, D.C. I studied in The Hague, in Canada, in South Africa, in all these universities. So I know what is Westernization and modernization.
Yeah.
But yet again, I have a deep roots with my cultural knowledge.
Yeah.
And this is the knowledge I want to share. So I am the balance. I'm the link between the two worlds.
Yeah.
And it's no contradiction. There's no contradiction at all.
Yeah.
I feel I'm one of those who think that I'm indebted to go back to my people and tell them, watch out. You're in a better place. do not think being westernized or being modernized, you are better than, this is a better world. It is not. Where you are is better, is the best place you are. Because you cannot, I have a story. At one time I was telling of a story of a bat. You know, a bat, the bat.
Yeah.
The bat. At one time there was a meeting. There was a conflict between birds and animals. And there was really a big conflict. And they decided to have a meeting so that they resolve the conflict. So they plan for a day and they say, we are meeting this particular day. Mm-hmm. But before the meeting started, birds had their own meeting separately and animals had their own meeting separately. But a bat came late and the meetings are going on the different groups. Mm. So she landed at the bat's group.
So wait, I don't understand what bat is then.
The bat is...
Chauve-souris.
Oh yeah, it's a chauve-souris, that's what I thought. Okay.
The bat.
Okay.
So the bat came late and landed where the birds are.
Okay.
And the birds look at her and they say, yeah, you fly, you look like us, exactly. Oh, but we have a meeting here with the animals, but really you fly, but you don't have a beak like a bird. You also have teeth. We don't have teeth. You have ears. Oh, you're not one of us. Please leave us alone. We have a private meeting. So the bird flew to the animals. The animals saw, landed. Uh-huh. And the animals get her, yes. Oh, yeah, you look like us. You got teeth. You got ears like us. But you fly. We don't fly. You're not one of us. Leave us alone. Mm-hmm. The bat is neither there nor there. It's hanging in between the two. I don't want my people, I don't want to be in between. I want to be rooted to where I belong.
Very important. Very important that you played this fantastic role of being a great bridge here. Last little question I have regarding women and men in your culture. How is that different? I mean, how do you women are seen? Because I feel you have a very balanced masculine energy, feminine masculine energy inside of you.
What I know from my mother and from my parents that the woman is the most important person in the Maasai community. She's called Enkitok. Enkitok is the almighty, the most powerful. Enkitok. And when you talk of Enkito is the wisdom of the elderly. Enkito, again, connotating the name of Enkitok. So Enkitok controls. She's the engine of mankind for the Maasai. She's really the engine of the mankind. All of us, the man and the women and the children, are just within the care of that woman. Mm. The Mother Earth. Why do you say the Mother Earth? Why don't you say the Father Earth? Mm. So the Mother Earth is the real mother. We are in the womb of the earth, the Mother Earth. We came from the womb of our mothers. Mm. So she's the most valuable being and the most powerful. And they've got a special place for the Maasai community.
Mm. Do you want to add something, Xavier?
For the Maasai, the holy feminine is a third category to reach all through the life, your life. You have to reach that third category to have accepted your part of femininity or part of masculinity. Then you reach Enkai. Then you can go back, as the Maasai say, Enkai or Sororua, you can come back to the uterus of the goddess, which means that you are ready for another life. I mean, you don't die, never die.
You go to sleep.
You go to sleep, of course. You go to sleep.
And then what? Where does the soul travel? Just a last little word to finish this interview. Where does the soul go, or where does the spirit go once we fall asleep?
The soul goes, the soul is with us. We are with our ancestors now as we talk. Mm. So it doesn't go nowhere. It is here. Mm. Huh? I mean, there is nowhere that it's gone there. It's here.
Yes.
Huh? But it's hard to understand.
Yeah.
But for me, when through the initiation, I know it is here.
Yeah.
I know I'm with my ancestors.
Yeah. It's all happening at the same time.
Same time. Mm-hmm.
It's not past, present, future. It's simultaneous.
Simultaneous. Do you agree? Do you agree, Zelia?
So we're not going anywhere.
No, we are not going anywhere.
Well, that's a great news. Thank you, Kenny. Thank you for this great interview. I look forward to doing another one. If you speak French, then you can watch the interview in French.
I hope at one time I will.
Thank you, Xavier.
Thank you.
I hope your book will be translated in English.
I hope, because it's so important.
What will be the title in English?
The nine lessons of the Maasai warrior.
Warrior.
Warrior. Pacific. Peaceful.
The Peaceful Warrior. That reminds me of Danny Millman that I had interviewed that wrote The Peaceful Warrior. I was at his place. Amazing. Amazing man. Thank you. Like you again.
And I appreciate the interview. And I would like to give a message to all the primary people.
Yeah.
That I think it is time now that we start telling our own stories. Not only telling orally, but also documenting and transmitting it. Not to ourselves, but to the whole world. Because that has been the missing link. That we should be able to open up ourselves to share with others. But and I would like also us, the modern world, the Western world, to listen to us, listen to our stories, accept that we have something to offer.
Mm. Yes. We're clear about that one. Thank you for sharing that video. much love, so my delicious co-creators. Much love. Asholin?
Asholin.
Asholin.
Thank you very much, Asholin.
I love it. Oh my God. Merci. Gros bisous.